Can you just put it on your chat? Okay. So I think I'm audible to most of the people. So I think if somebody is not hearing, maybe you can just check up whether your mic and this thing is right. Okay. So today's session, I have just put it into four different topics. That is the basics of Six Sigma. So we are going to give a very brief introduction and overview about the Six Sigma methodology. Then I'm going to present you two case studies based on my personal life, how the Six Sigma methodology helped me to solve a personal problem. And the other one is the professional problem where methodology really helped us to solve a marketing related issue for our company. Then I will just cover why Six Sigma certification is needed, what are the benefits of getting a Six Sigma certification, and then why Ice Cubes. So why you should take a certificate, or why you should take the training from our institute, that is Ice Cubes. Okay. So these are the four topics I'm going to cover today. So before starting the session, I would like to remember 15 years ago when my daughter was 9 years old. She had gone to the school first day after the summer vacation. When I returned home in the evening, I saw her looking dejected. She told me that all her classmates were narrating stories on their wonderful vacation during the holidays, and she was feeling bad as she had nothing to narrate. I was feeling even bad because I was the one who did not take her to her vacation outside because I did not have enough savings to spend for vacation, even though I earned $120,000 per annum. I was unable to save even a single penny for the last 5 years. So can I solve this problem by Six Sigma? Can I see the smile back on my daughter's face? So the answer for this, I think you'll be getting after 1 hour when I complete a particular course. So before starting the session, I would like to ask all of you to just park your questions for some time because since this is a session, I will not have any time to question in the middle of the session. You can just write your question on the chat. So after the session is completed, I will just take the questions from the chat one by one. So that means if you are the first one to put your question on the chat, then your question will be answered first. So after completing all the questions in the chat, then I will be available for taking any open questions. So with this introduction, I will just start about the basics of Six Sigma. So I would just like to start with a small story. So this is a story from one of the greatest epics in India, that is Mahabharata. So the story is about Guru Dronacharya, who was the guru for teaching all the war-related skills to the Pandavas and Kauravas. And one day, he asked all his disciples to one of the river bank, and then he just on the tree he just planted a bird made of clay, and then his target to the his students was that within one aim then they should be able to hit the bird. So then one by one the disciples started coming in to take the aim. First came Duryodhana, the eldest of the Kauravas. So when he came and started taking the aim, then Dronacharya asked Duryodhana, "What are you seeing?" Then Duryodhana told him that, "I am seeing the bird." Then the guru asked him, "What else are you seeing?" Then he told him that, "I am seeing the tree behind." Then he asked him, "What else are you seeing?" Then Duryodhana thought that he wanted to impress his guru. Then he started telling that, "I am seeing the river behind. I am seeing the mountain behind the river," and so on, so on. Then Guru Dronacharya told that, "Okay, don't take the aim, you just quit." So like that, one by one, all the Kauravas and Pandavas came, and then the Guru was asking similar questions, and all of them were answering in the same fashion, and then the Guru Dronacharya asked all of them to quit. Last came the chance of Arjuna. So when Arjuna came, again the Guru asked him, what are you seeing? Then Arjuna told that, "I am seeing the bird." Then Guru asked him, "What else are you seeing?" Then Arjuna told him that, "I am seeing the eye of the bird." Then again the Guru asked him, "What else are you seeing?" Then he told, "I am seeing the eyeball of the bird." Then the Guru Dronacharya asked, like, saw how he was holding the bow, how he was taking the aim, bows and arrows, whether they are made of good material, and then whether he is taking care of the breeze which is passing through, you know, while he taking the aim. And when he was satisfied that all his inputs and processes were right, then he gave the clearance to Arjuna to go ahead for shooting the arrow. Then Arjuna shot the arrow and bang, it hit the eyeball of the bird. So this story was maybe more than thousands of years old, but the concept is very good and it is actually valid even for now. What we call is the process approach. So your process is actually a set of activities which convert the inputs into outputs. So the fundamental principles on which Six Sigma methodology is built is what we call as a process approach, right? So what do you mean by a process approach? So the process approach says that if you want to have a control over the outputs, then you should have control over the inputs and you should have the control over the process conditions, right? So many times what we find that we are always in our mind, we are always bothered about the outputs, that my productivity is very low, my defect rate is very high, and then I am unable to turn around at the time of the customer. Then I'm getting a lot of customer complaints and so on and so on. So always the outputs are bothering us, and then every day we are going to our offices and then do the firefighting day in and day out. And we seldom have the time and resources to what is the problem in the inputs and what is the problems in the process conditions. But the basic philosophy of Six Sigma says that control the inputs, control the process, then the output will automatically be consistent and defect-free. So that's what we saw in the story, whatever you have seen earlier. So Dronacharya was insisting that the inputs were right. That means the bow and arrow were made of the correct material. And then the process conditions were same, were good. So that means the way he is holding the bow, the way he is taking the aim and everything. So all the process was right. And then once he was convinced that the inputs and process conditions were good, then he was 200% confident, then the output will automatically come and then he gave the clearance, right? So in the same philosophy is applicable for all our processes. If you want to have a consistent output, then we need to control the inputs and control the process conditions. So this is what we call it as a process approach. So we see that variability in any process is inevitable, right? So whether we are working in a manufacturing company or a service-related company or a software development company or a construction company or a pharmaceutical company, any process, or even in a natural process, we see that variability is always there. So sometimes our processes are running in an excellent condition, giving the excellent output. And then after a week or a month, we find that under the same conditions, we are getting a lot of rejections or our productivity is low. So that means this is being caused because of the variability in the process. So it is inevitable, right? So sometimes the variability in this variability in the outputs are caused by the variability in the inputs and the processes, right? So because again, whenever a raw material batch changes or whenever the machine condition changes or whenever the operator changes, then we find that the process parameters are changing, and then because of which the output, a lot of variation is coming, and then that is what is causing the problem for us. And then sometimes what we find that the variation is becoming too high that we start producing the defects, because you know that whatever the process we are doing, the customers always have a specification and then they have a tolerance, right? So they always give a plus minus tolerance, so within which your process characteristics has to lie. And if your product is going above or below the tolerances, then you are producing defects. And then these defects will not be accepted by the customer, right? So in the Six Sigma methodology, helps you to reduce the variations in the output by reducing the variations in the process conditions. So if you see, assume that this particular project, Six Sigma project, was done on reducing the defects, and then before the Six Sigma project was done, the average rejection was somewhere around 21%, And then the minimum variation was, minimum rejection was 15%, and the maximum variation was somewhere around 25%. So the minimum rejection was around 15%, and the maximum rejection was 25%, and the average was somewhere around 21%. And then after the Six Sigma project was done, and all the root causes for the particular problem was identified, and then actions were taken, after the project was completed, we find that there is a drastic reduction in the rejections, right? So the rejection, average rejection reduced from 21% to almost around 8%, and the variation is also reduced to around 6 to 10%, right? So whenever you are doing a Six Sigma project, so one of the important result, whatever you are getting, is the reduction in variability and substantial improvement in the metric, whatever you have taken for improvement. If you want to increase the productivity, so there will be substantial improvement in the productivity. If you want to reduce the defect rate, then there will be a substantial reduction in the rejection rate. And then we also find that it will be a substantial reduction in the variation in the output parameter. So the Six Sigma methodology helps the defects by reducing the variation in the process to near zero level by reducing variations in inputs and process. So whenever you talk about Six Sigma, the first thing what you need to come to your mind is Six Sigma helps in reducing the variations. So now come to the basic definition of what is the Six Sigma methodology. So Six Sigma is a data-driven statistical methodology that can be used to improve the quality and performance of the service to the highest levels by reducing variability in the process. So you can find that there are two major unique features of Six Sigma. The first one, it is a data-driven approach. And second thing is, it is actually using a lot of statistical tools. So doing a Six Sigma project, say for example, your company got a major problem with respect to the customer complaints or defect rate. And then your management says that, okay, I want you to take up a Six Sigma project and then drastically improve the, reduce the rejections within a month or so, then it is not at all possible. So Six Sigma methodology is not for any quick fix solutions. So it is a systematic and data-driven approach. So whenever we talk about solving a problem through a Six Sigma methodology, then we need to define the problem, then we need to measure, collect a lot of data, then we'll have to analyze the data using statistical tools, then we'll have to do the improvement, validate the improvement by statistical tools, and then should put up a control mechanism so that whatever the improvements we have achieved, we are able to sustain. So it is a systematic and data-driven approach. So quick fix solutions cannot be achieved through the Six Sigma methodology. So a Six Sigma project normally takes around 5 to 8 months to be completed. And it is a, you'll be able to find out the root cause of the problem and you will be solved the problems once for all. So this is a unique methodology where you collect a lot of data and use a lot of statistical tools, both during the analyze and improve phase, so that you'll be able to solve the problems, address, reduce the variations to the lowest possible level. So when a process is running at a Six Sigma level of quality, then the number of defects is only 3.4 defects per million opportunity. So that means if you are, assume that the aircraft landing is a process, right? So assume that over a month, so around 1 million aircraft landings are happening. And in these 1 million landings, so if that landing process is running in a Six Sigma level, then there will be only three defective landings per month, right? So that is what is the beauty of Six Sigma. That means the defect rate is so low. So that means normally we feel that 99% yield process, that means where we are producing only one, is a very good process. But again, when you compare that to a Six Sigma level of quality, so that means a Six Sigma process will produce 3,000 times less defects when compared to a 1% defect process, right? 99% accurate process. So you can find that the defect level is so low, so that the employee's morale will go up, and then their productivity will go up, defects will come down, and then your customer will be more satisfied. So that is the beauty of Six Sigma methodology. So when we talk about this Six Sigma methodology, this was first introduced in the year 1987 in Motorola, and then it was followed by Allied Signals and General Electricals. So when it was founded in 1987 in Motorola, it was not that something new was invented. No new concepts or no new tools were developed as a result of the Six Sigma method. It was only the question of the consultation of the existing tools and existing concepts. So there are already a lot of statistical tools and quality concepts were there. Maybe the control charts and the design of experiment. So these were some of the statistical tools which have been existing for almost 70 years by then. And then the concepts of lean and everything, so many concepts are already available for the last 50, 60 years. So it was not invention of any new tools or concept. It was only the consolidation of the existing tools and concepts. So say for example, you are having a problem in your house, an electrical problem in your house. So you call an electrician. So does he come empty handed? No, he comes with a tools pass in his hand, right? So what does he have in his tool, in his tools box? He's having a lot of tools to analyze the problem and then for solving the problem. So when you say that your fan is not running, then he will come there and then he will take out the tools like the tester or the test lamp to check where the power is coming, where the power is not coming. And then accordingly, he will just use these tools for analyzing the problem. And once he feels that, okay, find that this is the problem, then tools box, he'll be taking some other tools for solving the problem. Similarly, Six Sigma is actually a collection of tools, right? So where as a green belt or black belt project leader, you will be exposed to a lot of statistical tools and quality tools so that whenever a process problem comes, then you'll be able to solve and analyze and solve the problem using this statistical and other quality tools. So Six Sigma is nothing but a tools kit box for solving process problem. So any Six Sigma project is always taken, is driven by two factors. The first one is the customer satisfaction and second, financial savings, right? So the main major driving forces for any Six Sigma projects are customer satisfaction and financial benefit. So normally it is always wise to take a Six Sigma project to solve external customer problem, or sometimes you can also solve internal customer problem methodology. And then any Six Sigma project, you always look for whether substantial financial benefits you are able to achieve as a result of the project. So Six Sigma methodology projects are done following a DMAIC methodology. So it is a five-step method for improving the existing processes with unknown causes, right? So the DMAIC stands for define, measure, analyze, improve, and control. So whatever the Six Sigma project you are doing has to necessarily undergo these five phases in a Six Sigma project. So let us now see what is happening in each and every one of these phases. So in the define phase, we listen to the voice of the customer, and then we try to understand what are their pain points, and then try to identify a metric so that we'll be able to solve the problem. Say, for example, the customer is talking about delay. He may say that, okay, I have to wait a lot of, for the last 3 months, I'm finding that the lots from your company are always delayed. So this is the voice of customer. So when you listen to the voice of customer, then you let I see how you can relate it to a metric, which is a measurable metric, right? So maybe you are already measuring the percentage on-time delivery. Then you just see over the last 3 months, what has happened to the percentage on-time delivery. Maybe it was maintained at 98, and then maybe for the last 3 months, it has come down to maybe 92% or 90% or something like that. So that is becoming a pain to the customer. So you identify the metric for improvement, and then you just try to see what is the current performance. And then you just try to fix the target what you want to achieve. So you just write a problem statement which says that the percentage on-time delivery is low at 92%, and the goal of the project will be to increase it from 92% to 98%. By 6 months or so. And then you just define the scope of the project. So which process or which products are going to be covered. It is not necessary that all the products which is produced in your factory or office needs to be covered by the Six Sigma project. You can just select only one product line and say that the percentage on-time delivery for this particular product line produced at this particular location will be the scope of the project. Then you just calculate what are the benefits, then identify the project leader and the project team, and then write the formal project charter, and then get it signed by the senior management so that the project is formally launched. So this is what happens during the define phase. That means you you listen to the voice of customer, then identify the metric for improvement, So collect data on what is the current performance, then fix the target, fix the scope of the project, identify the team, identify the project leader, and then get the formal approval for the project to be started. So this is what is happening in the design phase. In the measure phase, we collect a lot of data on the process, right? So we try to identify what are the potential causes for the particular problem. And then we also do a measurement system analysis to ensure that our measurements are right and accurate. And then we also collect a lot of data to fix what is the current baseline, right? What is the current project? Then during the analyze phase, then we use a lot of whatever the data we have in the measure phase, we just put it into the statistical tools, and then we analyze, try to analyze what are the root causes for the problem. Maybe during the measure phase, when we started, we start with a fishbone diagram to identify potential list of all the causes, which may be around 30 to 40. And then during, again, we use some prioritizing tools in order to reduce, narrow down the root causes to around 10 to 15. And then we start collecting the data on the causes. And then during the analyze phase, we just input all this data into the statistical tools and then try to identify some three or four critical root causes which have major impact on the outcome, whether it is a product or the defect rate. And then the output from the analyze phase will be the statistically validated root cause, critical root causes for the problem. Then during the improve phase, whatever the three or four critical root causes you have identified, you just focus only on those critical root causes and take some improvement actions. And then you can also use some statistical tools or lean tools or some of the creative tools for solving the problem. And then once you have found out the solution, then you just conduct a risk analysis to see what are the risks in implementing the changes, and then whether you can take some proactive action so that be minimized. Then you just run some pilot runs to see what is the, whether you are able to achieve the improvement, whatever you have been targeting. Then once you have completed that pilot, and then you just see what is the savings you are going to get, and then you just prepare an implementation plan for how this particular improvement can be implemented throughout the organization. Then during the control phase, so whatever the two or three critical root causes you are identified, you just closely monitor it so that always it will be maintained in a very narrow range. And then you also consistently monitor the output parameter which you have taken for improvement. And then by closely monitoring the critical inputs and the output, and then taking immediate action, then you'll be able to sustain the improvements, whatever you have got. So this is what is the basic methodology through which the Six Sigma project is done: the define, measure, analyze, improve, and control. Then I have told you that Six Sigma is a structured approach. And then one of the structure is coming from the different phases, whatever we are going through. And the second structure is coming in terms of the organization structure, how the project is organized. So there are different types of people who are involved. So depending upon their involvement, then we are classifying them into white belt, yellow belt, green belt, black belt, master black belt, and champion. So the white belt are the people who are having the basic awareness of the Six Sigma methodology. Maybe the organization which wants to implement the Six Sigma methodology, they can just give 1 or 2 hours awareness session to all their employees so that they know what is the Six Sigma methodology mean. So the yellow belts have more training, maybe a 1-day or 2-day training, so that they will understand the basic concepts of Six Sigma, and then the importance of the data and the control mechanism. And then they will be helping they don't do lead independent project on their own. So they help either the green belt project leader or a black belt project leader in their project. So their main role will be for collecting the data during the measure phase. And then during the control phase, they will just help in implementing the solution and for the control of the critical access and the inputs and the output variable. So the green belts are the people who are trained maybe for a 3-to-3 training they undergo. And then they have some understanding of the statistical tools also. So they can either lead a small project within their own department, or they can just help the black belts in their own, in their projects. And then in the black belts, normally they are people from the middle management. So they should have a strong leadership skills. And then they just take complex process problems for solving. for which you need some help or coordination from the interdisciplinary coordination is required. So that is the reason why they will be given training on some complex statistical tools, and then they will be able to complete the project by coordinating the project activities with the other departments. So the master black belt is actually the person who is going to guide the project leaders. So normally, initially to an organization, he's going to be a consultant from outside. And then within 3 to 5 years, he can just train somebody internal to the organization, maybe the quality head or some of the process improvement head or somebody like that. So that over a period of 3 to 5 years, then they can train them to take care of the Six Sigma related activities. So they give the guidance for the project, like in which direction the project has to go. So they will also guide the project leaders what type of statistical tools and the quality tools should be used in the different phases. And then they also arrange for the review meeting with the senior management. So the champions are normally the people who are in the senior management, who are the process owners. And then they just help in identifying the Six Sigma project. They also help in identifying the Six Sigma project leaders. And then they provide all the administrative support to the project. So whenever the project is held up or is slowing down because of lack of resources in terms of material or resources like that, then the champion will be the person to be addressing all those problems, right? So this is how the Six Sigma is organized. So with this basic the overview about the Six Sigma methodology, I'm just going to give you two case studies. So the first case study is the problem I explained to you in the beginning, so from my personal life. So again, it was about to the people, for the benefit of the people who joined late. So the problem was that my daughter had gone to the school the first day after the summer vacation. And then in the evening when she returned, I found that she was feeling very sad. When I asked her the reason, then she told that all her other friends were narrating the wonderful experience they had during the winter vacation. But since she didn't go anywhere, so she was feeling very bad. I was also feeling very bad because I was the one who didn't take her anywhere because I didn't have the money. And then I didn't have the money because for the last 5 years, I was unable to save. So in the different phase, so first I listened to the voice of customer. My customer is my daughter. And the voice of customer says that she was feeling sad because she was unable to share her wonderful experiences in the vacation to her colleagues. And then the metrics I identified for the improvement was that savings, because if I had the proper saving, then I would have been able to take her to the vacation. And then the savings was the metric which I identified for improvement. So the problem statement was like the savings from my salary is 0% against a target of 5% for the last 5 years. And the goal statement said to increase the savings from 0% to 5% of my salary within 3 months. So the expected annual saving was around $6,000 and the project timeline was around 3 months. So this is the defined phase. So during the defined phase, I just collected the data for the last 1 year, how much I have spent on each of the heads. So I just classified the expenses in the different heads, like the rent, food, shopping, local travel, local repayment, health, education, etc. And then for the last 1 year, whatever the money I was spent on each one of these, then I just put it in a Pareto chart. And then I was able to find that the rent, then the food and shopping. So this alone was contributing to around 70% of the total expenses of over my income of around $120,000. So my income was around $120,000, out of which almost 70% was contributed by rent, food, and shopping. So again rent, I thought that I would not be able to do much about it because the house where I was there, it was nearer to my office of myself and my wife, and it was nearer to the schools of my kids. So, and then there was one of the low rent area house in that area. But again, food, we ourselves were surprised when we found that we are spending around $30,000 on food. So we thought that we will focus more on how we can reduce the expenses on food. Then I just collected the data for the last 1 year, month-wise data on how the total of $30,000 was spent on food. So month by month, we are finding that these are the variations we are getting. And then the minimum expenses on food was around $1,650, which was incurred during February. And the maximum was around $3,750, which was incurred during December. Then we find that there was a huge variation was there. And then I thought that it would be an ideal project for since we'll be able to reduce the variation. Then the identification of root causes, are I conducted a, did a sort of a fishbone diagram to find out what are the major causes for the high food expenses. So then I just divided into primary, secondary, outside food and snacks. So the primary food was mainly on rice, feed, bread, etc. The secondary food were like vegetables, oils, meat, etc. So like that. So then we were able to identify what are the different reasons contributing to the expenses, food expenses. So the then we did a cost and effect matrix. So this is one of the tools which you will be exposed to if you are undergoing a green belt or a black belt training program. So I try to reduce the food cost, but without having any impact on the health problem. So this is what we normally call it as a primary metric. So primary metric is the metric we want to improve as the outcome of the Six Sigma project. And the secondary metric is the metric which is going to have a negative impact on any of the actions taken by for improving the primary metric. So for example, I do not want to reduce the cost on food by increasing the cost on health. Because normally what happens is, if you take, if you want to reduce the food cost, then some of the nutritious and costlier food material you would like to avoid so that the overall food cost may come down. But again, this may result in a health problem. So this one normally happens in your regular process also. If you want to improve the productivity and take some action, maybe quality may be compromised. And vice versa, if you want to improve the quality, maybe productivity may be affected. So we will have to look for some solution by which both the primary and secondary metric both are increasing. Then we identified all the potential root causes. And then what is the effect of each of these on the food and the health related issue. And then we found that we identified the meat, restaurants, oil, ice creams, and chocolates. So these were the four critical root causes which are identified at the end of the analysis phase for the root causes for improvement. Then we took some actions so that in order to solve those root causes. So that means we reduced the consumption of meat from twice a week to once in a week. Previously, we were taking meat twice a week on both the weekends. Now we decided that we will have meat only once in a week. Then oil consumption was around 4 liters per month, which we reduced to 2 liters. And then we were previously going to restaurant once in a week. Now we decided that we will go once in a two. And we reduced the consumption of oil, ice creams, and chocolate. And then all these four actions, we found that it resulted in an annual cost saving of around $6,000. And more interestingly, our health expenses also reduced from $5,500 to $2,000. So this is mainly because whatever the actions we have taken are those which are also contributing to our health problem. So once we are able to reduce the expenses on this negatively contributing factors on health, then our overall health costs also came down. So this is what is the beauty of Six Sigma methodology. Whenever through a Six Sigma methodology, you want to improve the primary metric, that is the productivity, then the secondary metric, that is the quality, also will improve, and vice versa. Whenever you want to improve quality, then productivity also will improve. So that is what is the beauty of Six Sigma. Then during the control phase, then we just found that, we just did a comparison before and after. And then we found that before the project was done, the average monthly food expenses were around $2,500, which came down to $2,000 after the actions were taken, right? So now the my current status is that my annual saving has increased. My target was to increase it to 5%, but now I am finding that I am able to save 10% of my salary for the last 5 years. And my expenses on health and loan repayment has come down drastically. So that means what has happened is, like once I stopped or reduced the expenses on some bad expenses on food, then my health improved. And then since my savings, because these two contributed to my improved savings, and then since my savings improved, then I was able to make the loan payments on time or before time. So that also came down. So now these two are the objective or the tangible benefits I got from the project. Means I annual savings were increased and my expenses on health and loan repayment came down. And now the soft savings are the intangible benefits what I got, that I enjoy every summer. I just enjoy my vacation with my family. And more important to that, I'm just able to see happiness on my daughter's face, right? So now I think you have seen how I was able to solve a personal problem through Six Sigma methodology. So now I'm going to tell you about how the Six Sigma methodology helped in solving a real important problem in our marketing. So we always, I think most of you would have known, so we always are very active in LinkedIn, and we are just doing some sort of lead generation through LinkedIn. And then initially we found that the whenever the first activity was to send the invite to the LinkedIn members and then get them connected to us, right? And then when we found that for the last 3 months, we found that the percentage acceptance was very low at 27%. That means if we send 100 invitation to the LinkedIn members, so only 27 members were getting connected to us. So then this was actually, since the input itself was low, then the lead conversion was very low. Final lead conversion also was very low. And then that was affecting our revenue. So we thought that we will take that as a Six Sigma project. So the problem was that the conversion, the percentage invite acceptance was low at 27%. And then the target was to improve it from 27% to 50%. So the scope was only the first process, that is the invite acceptance from the members. And the scope was limited only to the LinkedIn. And we did the project for 3 months. And then initially when we started the project, then we had whenever we gave the invites, we just request the participants. The only criteria, whatever we were using, was that we'll be always sending the invite only to the with the Indian names. Like they may be like any location, like whether they may be in the Middle East or Africa or the Southeast Asian countries or US or Canada. But the only criteria was Indian name. And then we'll just send the invite to them. And then sometimes either they'll be connected or it will be pending, right? So this is the status. So this was our initial process. Then we found that, I think Mr. Ghulam, I think you are making something in your screen so that it is getting, some lines are getting formed. So please avoid that, Mr. Ghulam. Okay. So we are finding that on an average, we are finding that a lot of variation was there on a day-to-day condition. The minimum was around 25.5% and the maximum was around 28.7%. So this was the variation in conversion. Then we tried to analyze what are the different, the reason for the low acceptance. Then again, we did a fishbone diagram. Then we identified that the sex, like whether they were male or female, then their education level, the level of connection, whether they were second level connection or third level connection, the number of connections they had. So these are all the information which we could take from the LinkedIn. So whatever the data we could collect from the LinkedIn, so that we identified under the different heads. These are the potential root causes. Then we collected the data like in this format, like which sex, like to whom were we are sending the connection request. So then we just collected the data. So it has function, local education, vertical, etc., so on and so. And then we did statistical analysis. We call that as a hypothesis testing, chi-square testing. So this statistical tool we used in order to find out of those 10 or 15 root causes identified, which are all having the critical impact on the root causes. Then we identified that these are the critical, the sex, function, vertical. Function means whether it is the quality or production or maintenance, sales, purchase, etc. Vertical, that means whether it is manufacturing, services, software development, construction, etc. Certification, whether they already had a certification in as a green belt or a yellow belt or something like that. Level of connection, whether they were the second level or third level connection, and number of connections. So whatever the connection they had already had. And then we changed the process so that now in the process, instead of having only the Indian name as the only criteria, now we added all these six criteria also. Now we just gave the connection request only to those people. Like the sex, we found that only the male. These people are getting connected more. Then we just gave the request only to male. And then level of connection, we just gave connection request only to the second level of connection. Then we avoided giving a request to the people who are already certified, having the certification. Number of connections, we have it more than 100 connections that they were having so that they were active in LinkedIn. And function mostly related to production, quality, maintenance, etc. And then any vertical. So, and then we again collected the data after the project was completed. So initially we found that the average was around 27%. So after these actions were taken, we found that the average has gone up to more than 60%. Then again, we did a statistical validation to check whether we are getting significant improvement. And then we were able to find that since the p-value is more less than 0.05. So this again is a statistical tool. So we found that there was a significant improvement was there. You can find that initially it was only 27% conversion was there, which has now increased to more than 61%. So then again, we also plotted a control chart. So again, we found that there was a significant improvement in the metric, whatever we wanted to improve. and the variation has also come down. So the accidents, whatever you are seeing, even now after 3 months of, after the complete, what we are finding is that we are now inviting only the male members for our LinkedIn. And then we just invite only the people from production, purchase and quality functions. We tend to avoid people from marketing and finance. Then only manufacturing and ITS vectors, not others. Then only the second level connections and with the number of connections with more than 100. And only those certifications are invited. So these are the actions we have taken. And then once we have taken, once we are sending these invites to these people only, then we are finding that our conversion rate is very high. So now I think I have given you a case studies, two case studies, one on how Six Sigma has helped me to solve some personal problems and some process problems. So now let us see why or what are the advantages of getting a Six Sigma certification. So the first one is the job opportunity in reputed companies. So I was actually graduated in the year 1985, and for around 22 years I was working in manufacturing. But then only because of my Six Sigma experience, then I was able to shift from a manufacturing company to an ITS company. And then for the last 5 years, I'm a consultant. And now I'm just working for companies like Amazon, Rocket, and then some of the drilling service company in Oman. And such companies I would have never dreamt of if I had continued in the same company without any exposure to Six Sigma. So there is a lot of opportunities for Six Sigma certified people in reputed companies like TCS or Cognizant or Amazon or Flipkart or so many things. So that having a Six Sigma certification will help them in getting opportunity in reputed companies. Then career advancement. So whether you are Mr. Sanjeev Kumar, please, I think. Okay. So there is some, it will help you for your career advancement. So either you are in the same company or you want to shift to some other job, then you will be able to grow fast in your career if you are having a Six Sigma certification. Then the very important thing is that it is the applicability across industries. If you are a Six Sigma certified person, then you'll be able to migrate to from one vertical to other vertical, just like how I migrated from electronic component manufacturing industry to ITS someday, and then from consultancy, where I'm now giving consultancy services to almost all industries, right? And then about the roles, so whether you are a quality executive or leader or manager or a production executive or a HR or operation, or you are a functional manager or engineer, pharmacy, R&D, software, restaurants, retail, then warehouse or inventory executive. So any type of industry, any type of role up to the middle or senior management, then you'll be exposed to Six Sigma methodology will help you to come climb up very fast in the career. So then, why IceCube? What are the advantages of taking the Six Sigma certification or training in IceCube? So the trainer with 35 years of experience in manufacturing and IT services. So I have vast experience over the last 35 years, both in manufacturing and IT services. I have also worked both in my production as well as the quality function. So I was certified as a black belt in the year 2004 and as a black belt, master black belt in the year 2013. So for the last 16 years, I have been now involved in the Six Sigma training. And I'm working on Lean Six Sigma implementation and project guidance services to Amazon, Tizis, Rocket. Rocket is the fourth largest starch manufacturer in the world, and they are the biggest starch manufacturer in India. Abraj is actually one of the drilling services company in Oman. So these are the companies where I'm providing the Six Sigma implementation. Then the Lean Six Sigma training, I have already taken courses, corporate training in Hyundai Motors, then TUV Germany, then L&T Valves, Tata Communications, Mahindra Finance, Standard Chartered Bank, Pfizer Healthcare, etc. So the unique the teaching style is that it is a simple and easy to understand presentation without compromising the complexity or quality of the content. Ample examples from manufacturing, service or software development and real life, so that you will always be able to relate it to the area of work or real life, so that you will be able to easily understand the concepts. So interactive sessions with presentations containing relevant images and videos. So you can find that a lot of stories and images and videos will be there along with the content, so that you'll be able to easily understand the concept. And then we are also doing the project guidance that are a very nominal charges. So we always help the participants to take up some projects so that they'll be able to implement their learnings in the project. And then flexible time session timings to suit participants across the globe, because there are participants who are coming, joining from US, Canada, Middle East, Africa, and from Asian countries. So we have run normally two different batches. one starting from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. Indian Standard Time, and another batch from 6:30 to 10:30 in the evening. So that in any one of these batches, I think the participant can be accommodated. So the other important aspect is like whenever if you undergo the green belt or black belt training in any other training institute, like they just you undergo the green belt, and then within a period of maybe 3 months or 6 months or 1 year or a few years, then again you take the black belt training program. So your certificate is a black belt. Then you just go and attend an interview, but maybe perhaps you don't have any implementation experience or implementation knowledge, so that you may not be able to answer properly in the interview and you may not be selected. But if you are taking the training from Ice Cubes, then maybe if you take a green belt project, again, you can take up a small project and then we will give you the project guidance so that you'll be able to implement all those tools and concepts, whatever you have learned. And then again, you can just take up the black belt training with us. And then again, you can also do some sort of a project. We will guide you so that you'll complete both the green belt and black belt project after reasonably doing some one or two projects before you complete the project, so that you'll be able to practice more and more on the quality tools and concepts, so that whenever you are applying for any interview, then you will be able to impress the people who really matter. So this is one thing. That means we are always helping you, the participants, for taking up some projects, and then we'll give the guidance for completing the project. Then the other important unique feature with Ice Cubes is, say for example, if you take the training from the others, say for example, yellow belt, green belt, and black belt, if you say the three different certifications, so the yellow belt will contain 50% of the content when compared to the black belt. Green belt will contain around 75% of the content when compared to the black belt. And black belt is 100% of the content. So I'm just given some notional values here for the certification cost, training cost. Maybe assume that they are charging $100 for the yellow belt program, $250 for the green belt, and $500 for the black belt. So then if you take any training from any outside institute, for the same 50% content, you are actually paying thrice, right? At the yellow belt, green belt, and black belt, right? So that the total cost, whatever you're going to get, incur is around $850, right? So that means for the same content of 50% content, you are going to pay thrice. But again, if you take the training from us, we are having a system by which you'll be able to, one thing is the basic cost itself is less when compared to the other institutes. The basic cost itself is less. And then whenever you want to go from yellow belt to green belt, then you just pay only the differential cost. That means if assume that yellow belt is $70 and green belt is $200, if you have completed the yellow belt for paying $75, pay $200 for the green belt, you can just pay $125. Same way, whenever you want to move from green belt to black belt, you just pay the differential cost between $350 and $200. So that means the overall total cost will be $350. So this main difference is mainly because of two reasons. One is the overall, the cost at